I'm Joe Bob Briggs, and it's Werewolf Night here at Monstervision. Our first flick is The Howling 3, The Marsupials, which puts werewolves in the kangaroo family. And then we skip a few years to Howling 7, the one where the werewolves learn to line dance at a country western bar outside Barstow. Don't ask, just go with it, okay? I went to a wedding today. Ask me if I'm happy. It was one of Wanda Bodine's 64 cousins. I'm not going to name her on national TV, but the size of these bridesmaids. I mean, it wouldn't be so bad if it wasn't for the bridesmaids' outfits, but they had so much chiffon on. We're talking Weight Watchers from outer space, okay? Why do women do that? You're taking the Chrysler Building and putting Victoria's Secret lingerie on there. Silver mini dresses with Gone with the Wind lace collars on them, like a Star Trek convention that got freeze-dried. And I think the bride was going for some kind of Barbarella effect, but you know what happens when you put 300 pounds worth of direct downward pressure on a spiked high heel? Besides tearing up the hardwood floors in the Methodist church, those things start to crack. There's little tiny fissures, you know, like an earthquake or a glacier, and you never know the exact moment when it's going to happen, but you know at some point a bridesmaid is going down. You know, they're standing up there by the preacher. He's saying, "Do you take this man?" or something. All of a sudden, three of them crack at once, like stripping paint off a chiffon robe. And you know those silver support struts? They're starting to wobble there, and you can get a domino effect. I mean, if one bridesmaid starts windmilling her arms to stay in balance, the next bridesmaid can get an eye poked out and end up plunging through the baby Jesus stained glass window. So anyhow, that was depressing enough. But this was also one of those reformed slut weddings. This gal qualified 3 years in a row as a United Way agency. So here's my question. Why is it that whenever a girl like this gets married, she always marries a bald-headed religious guy? We're talking about a woman who has never had both legs in the same zip code at the same time, right? And she's going to go get a little starter home in the suburbs with Buster the Baptist deacon? And my other question is, what's in it for Buster? You know, what are they going to do afterwards? Discuss Leviticus or something? And doesn't it ever occur to Buster that if she's been having sex 947 times a day for the last 10 years, maybe he might be a little lean in the leotards when it comes to satisfying this woman? If she cheats on him, what's he going to say to the divorce court judge? "Well, I knew she was a floozy, but I thought it was her dream to cook and clean all day for me and our 8 little dirty-faced barefoot kids." Meanwhile, we all stand around eating cheap angel food cake that tastes like cardboard and sipping white wine out of this plastic cup and saying, "Aren't they beautiful together? Isn't this wonderful?" How did this tradition get started? That's my question. Okay, sorry to get personal there on you, but speaking of howling at the moon, we have one of the best Howling sequels coming up right now, Howling 3. And then in the interest of scientific comparison, later on we'll have one of the looniest Howlings, Howling 7, which was apparently made after they started licensing the Howling name to anybody with an 8mm Kodak camera. So anyway, this first one is about a couple of Australian character actors who help a wild and sexy gal with hair on her tummy and her little rodent wear baby and a Russian ballerina escape extinction by the Pope and the President of the United States, who for some reason has an Australian accent, even though they turn into werewolves and start eating folks every time somebody takes their picture. Did you follow that? The point being, werewolves are people, too. We'll do the drive-in totals in the first break, and let's go. Let's just watch the movie. Y'all don't think I'm cynical about marriage, do you? I'm not, because I'm not cynical about marriage. I think everybody should get married at least 3 or 4 times just to understand the suffering of others. When you enter the Monstervision caption contest, don't just string a bunch of cuss words together and tell us that's funny. Only Jack Nicholson can do that. If you really want that Monstervision t-shirt, then impress me with your sincerity. Try something witty, or at least amusing. Don't make us snicker. Make us roar with unabashed delight. Go to tnt.turner.com/Monstervision and make the six-headed jury laugh and turn over a new leaf in your life, okay?
Play the Monster Caption Contest and win a free t-shirt at tnt.turner.com/Monstervision.
Back to Monstervision host Joe Bob Briggs and Howling 3 on TNT.
Ah, yes, the science fiction classic, It Came from Uranus. This is one goofy movie. I really like this. The original Howling was made in 1981 and was directed by the sometimes brilliant and sometimes not so brilliant Joe Dante. The Howling is a great flick. The Howling 2, on the other hand, was so pitiful they had to put lipstick on Christopher Lee and dress Sybil Danning up in a wolf suit and then run an instant replay of Sybil ripping off her blouse 14 times during the closing credits. In other words, pretty darn lame movie. But here's what's weird. The director of Howling 2, Philippe Mora, which was maybe the worst one in the whole series, and it's not a great series, also made this one. Because by the time the second one came out, he was already signed up to do this one. And what do these guys always do when they think their horror franchise is getting lame? They make the next one campy, right? They put a crazy guy named Junior in it, or they use all kinds of fisheye lenses, or they put a cheesy horror movie within a horror movie in there to show that they can laugh at themselves, and that's what we have here, isn't it? Well, it's kind of campy, and it's kind of like something you'd see on the Discovery Channel. One guy wrote in to me from a U.S. naval base where they're apparently desperate for entertainment and said it should be called Those Amazing Marsupials. But I'm getting ahead of myself. I promised you those drive-in totals, so let's do them now. We have 29 dead bodies, one dead kangaroo, no breasts, throat ripping, exploding tent, killer nuns, marsupial childbirth, werewolf ballet, werewolf voodoo, cheesy movie within a movie, hypnosis foo, 4 stars. Check it out, and we'll be here for the full Howling experience. Roll it. Did I just say Howling 2 was the worst sequel in the series? I think I said that. The only reason I can say that now is that you haven't seen our second feature, Howling 7. You could actually have entire academic seminars devoted to the topic, which is the worst Howling sequel, and you're not allowed to say all of them. Vote only once and don't look at your neighbor's ballot, okay? When the moon gets waxy, the were gets wolfy. All right, if you're going to write in to us here at MonsterVision and share your gripes, your opinions, whatever, and you're a woman under 140 pounds, single, and you don't have any strong opinions about any of the most common vices that men have, then I want you to use my home address because it's quicker. So just send those letters. What? I cleared this. Hey. I can do this. I'm telling you, we had a 3-hour meeting about this. It's not an attempt to get nookie on TV. Well, you don't have to use that word. Look. All right, look, I'm going to have to get back to you later. But meanwhile, just keep writing to us at 1010 Techwood Drive, Atlanta, Georgia, 30318, and emailing us at monstervision@turner.com. I like Superfly. What are you saying about Superfly? Why do you use that word? What's the implication there?
Visit the MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision. Back to MonsterVision host Joe Bob Briggs and Howling 3 on TNT.
You gotta love a movie with werewolf nuns. But I feel like we're missing a few scenes here because I'm confused. Did she get hit by a car? Or did she just collapse in the street mid-transformation? Or what happened there? That's Imogen Ansley as Jerboa the Wolf Babe. And she is a fine-looking woman, isn't she? Even if she does have stomach hair. She looks a little bit like Linda Hamilton. Linda Hamilton mixed with Mila Jovovich. Remember her from the immortal Return to Blue Lagoon? Mila Jovovich, she's some kind of L'Oreal spokesmodel now. Actually, I don't think she spokes. She just models. Ever since Blue Lagoon, they don't let Mila talk very much. And that's Lee Biolos as Donnie. This was the first in a series of one movie for Lee. All righty, the werewolf nuns just killed 16 people in one fell swoop, so let's roll it. We got another good scene coming up here. It's a good movie. Mila Jovovich was, she was in that Bruce Willis movie, The Fifth Element.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't see that. Did they give her any lines in that?
Well, a couple.
She also put an album out a few years ago, probably funded by proceeds from her Banana Republic ads. I know more about Mila Jovovich than any man alive. Whenever they have that Mila Jovovich category on Jeopardy, I kill her. She shaves her armpits twice a week. I know everything.
Joe Bob doesn't get nearly as much hate mail as people think he gets. I know because I'm Rusty, the MonsterVision mail girl, and most of the letters I see are almost positive. I'm not counting the ones from TNT programming executives, because that's really not mail. Those are memos. Anyway, I do see your letters, and I do love every one of them. So come visit us at the Monstervision website at tnt.turner.com/Monstervision. Or contact us the old-fashioned way at 1010 Techwood Drive, Atlanta, Georgia, 30318. You can even email us at monstervision@turner.com. Try to avoid phrases like lame, no-talent donkeys behind. You can't imagine how Joe Bob overreacts to those.
See Rusty deliver the Monster Vision fan mail to Joe Bob Briggs every Saturday night on TNT. Back to Monster Vision host Joe Bob Briggs and Howling 3 on TNT.
All right, I ask you, is that one of the most original characters in horror film history? The aging Russian ballerina werewolfess who journeys to Australia to mate with her bald-headed stud wolf she feels a spiritual bond with. Is that a great character? And the wolf transformation while on point? I think we may be in the hands of a genius here. Do you? Australian writer-director Philippe Mora, maker of the killer pig flick Razorback. But I have a question. Jerboa shows Donnie the little slime monster, right? And what does he say? It's beautiful. It's not beautiful. It looks like Yoda. It's like a shaved rat with KY jelly smeared all over it. I don't think he was looking at the little fetus. I think he was looking at her chest of drawers, if you know what I mean, and I think you do. Now, that inspires an it's beautiful. Okay, back to El Flico de Cinema. Practicing my Spanish because I got a trip to Mexico planned for this year's Chihuahua Perfecta.
All right.
Ernie's been teaching me some stuff to say. 100 pesos on numero uno to win, por favor.
That's right.
Yes? ¿Dónde está la cerveza? Is that right?
Sí.
What's the other one, Ernie? Oh, tu madre está una estacionamiento. Your mother is the size of a parking lot. See, they love it when you speak like a native.
Back to Monster Vision host Joe Bob Briggs and Howling 3 on TNT.
One of the few marsupial carnivores descended from the extinct Tasmanian wolf. Of course! I love this story. Now, if you're like me, you may be wondering, what was there really something called a Tasmanian wolf? Yes! The crack TNT research department has found the Tasmanian wolf. What happened is that when settlers moved into Tasmania, the Tasmanian wolf, or thylacine, which actually sounds like an antibiotic instead of a wolf, but anyway, the thylacine killed all their sheep, so a land company put a bounty on them. Then the government took over, paying 25 bucks a scalp, which was a lot of dough in 1890, because kill a couple of those guys, you could open a little pub in the outback. You were made. But in 1910, the Tasmanian government stopped paying for the skins, and after the last one died in a zoo in the 1930s, the government said anybody who killed a thylacine had to pay a $500 fine. Poor planning, considering there weren't any left. Should have charged people a fine when they were carting the carcasses into town by the truckload. This is why governments always have to raise the dang taxes. And speaking of poor planning, real smart giving half the exposition scenes to the Russian actress in this movie. We are liking from bot human, bot wolf. Ask me how many times I had to play that back to figure that out. She's actually Czech. She's not Russian. Dagmar Blahova is her name. Dagmar Blahova. She makes movies in the Czech Republic. They have names like Pasti Pasti Pastiski and A Pozdravuji Vlastovki, which I believe translates to Sorority Babes in Prague, the Spandex Revolution. Okay, let's go. Howling 3, the Marsupials. We all have our favorite Dagmar Blahova flick, I think. Mine is Nechsi Nik Sliset, Attack of the Killer Loaf of Rye Bread. Do you know how often people rip off our MonsterVision website? I'm proud of that. They want to share what they find there with the whole world, and that's what the web is all about. Of course, we get the TNT lawyers to hunt them down like dogs, but you don't know what you're missing if you haven't been to the site lately. Not just the weird beard mail, not just the Playmate stuff, not just the transcripts and the downloadable photos, but we're adding new stuff all the time. New stuff to steal. so we can sue their butts. Check it out at the tnt.turner.com/monstervision. We don't really sue them. We get a couple of grease monkeys to rough them up a little bit.
Visit the Monstervision website at tnt.turner.com/monstervision.
Back to Monstervision host Joe Bob Briggs and Howling 3 on TNT.
Okay, while the hunters venture into the bush, and since I have no idea what they were just talking about, I'd say it's time for Joe Bob's Jailbreak, where we read some mail from the fine penal institutions of America. And here to help us out is one of my favorite members of the species, Rusty, the TNT mail girl. You know, Rusty, we're venturing into the bush tonight.
Really?
Yes, it's animal rights night, because I know about your interest in animal rights, so we're doing that especially for you.
What are those? Snake skin?
The boots?
Mm-hmm.
No, shark skin. All my boots are shark skin.
Sharks are living creatures, too.
Well, sort of, but not anymore. These aren't, because right now this shark is a boot. But I always stop by the Tony Lama factory in El Paso when I go down there, and they make these things for me. I go down to Juarez for the bullfights.
You shouldn't go to bullfights. They're totally cruel and inhumane.
Well, they don't kill the bulls. In Juarez, they don't kill them. They just torture them a little bit.
No. Promise me you won't go to them anymore.
Well, what'll you give me if I promise? Will you have a drink with me after the show? Let's start with that, okay?
And then you'll never support those terrible people again.
Bullfighting is cruel and inhumane. I agree with you.
Okay. One quick drink. But I'm paying for it myself.
You're paying for it, but you'll actually drink it, right? Any drink of my choice, right? Do you have a letter for me?
I do.
And
this
you'll drink
one.
It.
Yes.
Okay.
It's from Michael Pounds at South Central Prison in Clifton, Tennessee.
All right. You know how they put these stamps on here? Censored. This prison not responsible for contents. You get a lot of these. Dear Joe Bob and Bunny. Who's Bunny? Just another letter from South Central in Tennessee, and thought you might like to know a few other luxuries about this pit. Handball, volleyball, shuffleboard, arts and crafts, drug and alcohol rehab, softball, school, a library with no law library, tattoos, etc. This sounds like a health spa. You know, we thought we were getting a good deal over a minimum wage job, except half of our money goes to living expenses. We're wards of the state. 25% goes to victims' compensation, and 5% goes toward the release upon parole, in which you can't touch, and the other 20% goes into an account in which these dolts collect interest. The clinic has found a miracle drug that heals arthritis, cancer, gout, and the common pain in the butt, Tylenol. But for them to tell you the secret, you have to pay $3 to see a nurse. My roommate would like to see Bunny nude, but I would love to have an autographed picture of her. Your friend, Michael Pounds, a.k.a. Kilo. Michael's nickname is Kilo in South Central Prison in Tennessee. Well, Michael, if you mean Rusty, I think you mean Rusty, not Bunny. Your roommate's not the only one who would like to see her nude, if you know what I mean. And I'm sure she'll be happy to know that they won't have to do any more animal testing for cancer since your prison has found the cure. Right, Rusty? So good going, South Central. South Central Prison is located in Clifton, Tennessee, population 700. They have 1,500 male inmates, so twice the population of the town. It's medium to minimum security. Most of them are in for pretty long terms. And Michael pretty much covered what they do for fun there. So thanks for writing in, Mike. We love a captive audience. Free your mind, and your butt will follow. So I'll swing by your dressing room after the show.
Oh, you promise no more bullfights?
Absolutely. And wait till the guys down at the dog track hear I'm going out with you, because...
Joe Bob, you don't patronize dog tracks.
Let me ask you something. You have a dog?
Yes.
What do you feed your dog?
Dog food.
You know what's in dog food? Animals. Animals are in dog food.
You are such a hypocrite.
No. So I'll see you a little later, huh? Rusty? Bunny? Rusty? We'll go to Blockbuster and watch Bambi. I love the scene where Bambi's mother is killed in cold blood. Only kidding. Little animal rights humor, okay?
Two.
You know, my philosophy of viewer mail, who needs the heartache? Get rid of it. Unfortunately, TNT insists that you continue to pummel me with your incredibly diverse and somewhat frightening opinions. There are two ways to do this. You can write to us at Monstervision, care of TNT Programming, 1010 Techwood Drive, Atlanta, Georgia, 30318. Or you can use the ways of the truly disturbed. You can email us at monstervision@turner.com. I thank you, Ted Turner thanks you, and Bill Gates thanks you.
Visit the MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision. Back to MonsterVision host Joe Bob Briggs and Howling 3 on TNT.
Isn't that a great goofball scene when the guy in the wolf suit attacks the hunters and none of them get off a single shot? Did all their shotguns jam at the same moment? Then we had the attack by the skeleton werewolf. And then, of course, it goes without saying, the huge explosion when the army has to turn the bazooka on Philo, the now sympathetic Nazi werewolf leader of a decimated people. The special effects on this picture were done by Bob McCarron, who also did that killer pig movie, Razorback, which I mentioned earlier. And he worked on the Mad Max flicks. And some people say his best work was transforming Linda Hunt into Mel Gibson's male sidekick in The Year of Living Dangerously. Now, that's some special effects work. Well, actually, how hard is that, making Linda Hunt look like a guy? Okay, it's time for the exciting conclusion to The Howling 3, The Marsupials. Go. Making Linda Hunt look like a woman. Now, that would be a special effect. What?
Stay tuned for more Joe Bob Briggs on Joe Bob's Last Call, coming up next on TNT. And now, Joe Bob's Last Call and Howling 7, New Moon Rising on TNT.
The plot of that movie just continually spins in new and unexpected directions. And the woman presenting the Oscar at the end, that's Barry Humphries in drag, the guy who does Dame Edna Everidge. Great movie. Unfortunately, our next movie is The Howling 7, which was apparently made by three drunk rednecks with a camcorder. Anyhow, I'm Joe Bob Briggs, and next week we have another franchise-type double feature, only this time they're actually showing them in the right order. It's the best Gremlins ripoff of 1984, Ghoulies, which will follow up with Ghoulies 2, and of course, both flicks feature midgets in serious dramatic roles. Now, there's a lot of resemblance between the various Howling movies. For example, they all have the word howling in their title. In fact, that's the main thing that they have in common. So I'll still synopsize the missing Howlings for you, though, to put your mind at ease as we skip to part 7. Now, we just watched The Howling 3. The Howling 4 takes place in a town called Drago, and the werewolves look like German shepherds with a shag rug strapped to their back. And that's about all you need to know about that one. Howling 5 is basically Gilligan's Island in a Hungarian castle with a body count. Howling 6 is pretty decent. It's sort of the feminist Howling. And that brings us to The Howling 7. Now, remember when I said that a bunch of people wrote in to warn me of the awfulness of The Howling 3? Where were you guys on this one? Number 3 is like Casablanca compared to number 7. You know, Clive Turner, this guy named Clive Turner, wrote, produced, directed, edited, and he stars as a two-stepping hippie cowboy who gets a job in a small-town bar where a bunch of locals stand around and tell each other bad jokes while people get attacked by a werewolf off-camera. And the locals of the town are played by the actual locals of this town where it was filmed, for better or worse, so I'll let you decide, but let's do to the drive-in totals, and then we'll get started. We have 23 dead bodies, 4 dead werewolves, throat ripping, tourist hacking, head rolls, melting husband, lethal chili con carne, gratuitous line dancing, gratuitous sing-along, billy club foo, more gratuitous line dancing. I give it about 1.5 star. So check it out, and please do not leave me alone with this movie, okay? See, I'm no longer allowed to advise the use of a cold foamer to get through a movie. That's not allowed anymore by TNT standards and practices. Those wonderful people there, I think they're related to the house managers. That's all I'm going to say, all right?